Our work session briefing session to order. The first order of business is to discuss the agenda items. And if you think you can hold it till we get out there, we've got a busy schedule tonight. But go ahead, take that with us.
Thank you, Mayor and Council. Tonight on the consent agenda, item 4A are the minutes for the December 20th regular city council meeting. Item 4B is a resolution authorizing procurement of emergency medical supplies from Boundtree Medical Products. This is through a City of Cedar Hill contract, and it's an annual estimated expenditure of $60,500. This is a company we've been buying supplies from. These are expendable type medical supplies. In the past, the expenditures have been less than $50,000, so they have not come before council. We expect them to go over $50,000 now, so that's why we're bringing this to you. Item 4C is a resolution authorizing procurement, annual procurement of hot mix asphalt with Alston Asphalt LP. And this is an estimated annual expenditure of $67,493. And this is for our annual paving projects. And we will pay that at the unit price as we use the asphalt. Item 4D is a resolution rejecting bids for the North Main Street Phase 2 emergency generator and water quality improvements. This bid was put out, or this project was put out for bid late last year. Bids were opened on December 15th. We only received one bid on that project. The engineer's estimate for the project was $680,000. The bid was $820,000. And so it was well over the estimated amount. And in talking with various contractors, a number of them said that they had problems getting subcontractors to give them prices because of the holidays. So we feel like rejecting the bids and then rebidding it that we will get better prices. So this action is for you to approve rejection of bids and authorizing staff to rebid the project. Item 4E. A resolution to award a contract with pavement marking supply and installation services to Action Commercial Services of Rockwall, Texas, and this is in an estimated amount of $76,708. And this is for thermoplastic markings and the buttons that go in the lane marker buttons. Item 4F is a resolution authorizing the County of Dallas to resell a tax foreclosed property that has been struck off to the City of Duncanville. This local property is 4 Belmont Place. This is a vacant property in the Thoroughbred Hills subdivision. This property had previously been on a list of foreclosed properties for resale. In 2013, it was taken off of the list then at the county's request because it was a vacant property and they didn't feel like they were going to be able to find anyone to buy it. So they requested it be taken off. There is a potential buyer for the property now, and so this action would authorize the county to sell it. The next item, 4G, is a resolution authorizing Reinbarger, Gogan, Blair, and Sampson to obtain order of sale. And this is essentially for other tax foreclosed properties to authorize Dallas County to sell them or to put them up for auction at the sheriff's sale. Those properties are 1311 Cockrell Hill, 414 Rock Rose, 1204 Crest Lane Drive, 603 Woodhaven, and 141 Greystone Place. Two of those locations are actually vacant properties. One is in the Homestead Edition at Big Stone Gap. Item 4H is a resolution to award bid for water and wastewater improvements to Raytech Services, amount of $518,078.65. This project is to extend new sewer lines to 33 unserved parcels along South Ladima Lane, Joe's Drive, Tango Lane, and a portion of Frank Keesler Boulevard.
Does that complete then, that project?
Will that complete that project?
Yes.
Or is there another phase after this, or will that complete?
There was already a phase for this.
Right.
And this is the second phase, and that will complete that area with the water and wastewater.
And then we get our signal light?
That's
Actually about to start this month.
We're going to have cameras and stuff? And ribbon cutting?
Oh, ribbon cutting.
It's such a short deal.
We can certainly make arrangements.
The Rotary Club got to see the cabinet this morning at their presentation, because Mike did a presentation to them and had all this show and tell stuff, and he had the actual cabinet that is going up there.
They're breaking it in right now. They have run it for so many hours before on breaking in, is that right?
Burn in all the components and make sure they function.
It looks nice.
That part of it.
That's definitely.
We would have invited you to Rotary Club this morning, but it's 7:00 maybe.
I was at SMU, thank you.
And then item 5I is a resolution to award the first of 2 1-year renewal options for a contract with for traffic signal maintenance services to Siemens Industry. And this is the first of two 1-year renewals. That is all the consent.
Can we go back to 4B for a second? Included in the background were some several letters that showed that some of the medical supply companies were changing the prices and going up on. And I wonder where, if we've got a contract, don't they have to guarantee their prices during the life of the contract?
On the emergency medical supplies contract, yeah. Aren't those prices guaranteed for the life of the contract?
They're guaranteed for a year at a time, as I recall, and they have an escalation option each time they renew, and the contract's been renewed a couple of times. We got a letter, Cedar Hill got a letter, as the leader of the contract earlier this year.
I saw that in fact.
Yeah. But they have escalation options after, that's your
first. But it only applies for the new contract coming in. The existing contract, they guarantee the old prices.
For this current contract, it applied to that last term in that contract.
Yes, for this term. So when we're renewing it, the new prices would go into effect.
Yeah.
For that they are offering.
Okay. I just wanted to make sure they weren't going up midstream on us.
Not in the middle of the term.
Right. And they're going to be rebidding this. It's running out of terms now, so they'll be rebidding the contract here. Coming weeks now.
So all the consent items on the regular agenda. The first item is a public hearing and rezoning for the lot at 243 West Vineyard. This is a rezoning from R1.4 single family to NR neighborhood retail. You may recall this is the lot that is directly behind the small commercial property on the corner of Vineyard and Wheatland. It's across from the assisted living facility. This particular lot was the one that was in tax foreclosure about a year ago or so. Council approved reselling that property or allowing the county to sell it. It was sold. The person that owns that commercial property on the corner of Vineyard and
Peach and Wheatland,
on the corner of Peach and Wheatland, that commercial property bought that property behind him on the corner of Peach and Vineyard, and now is requesting to rezone it. And his intention is to construct a parking lot on that to serve that commercial property. If you recall, it was one of the things that we talked about at the time, is that commercial property is very restricted on parking, has very little parking in the front of it, so he is bringing this now for rezoning, and then if he gets the rezoning, it's in his intention to replat the entire property there right past the town.
What's the status? There's a picture in there of the proposed parking lot. Geometrically, that won't work. That's not what they're putting on the building, is it?
That's a schematic. I mean, they're pending zoning approval, and they'll have to submit construction documents in compliance with all of the standards for the parking lot size, the spaces, and the drive widths and everything.
Yeah, the driveways are not
properly
located.
Yeah.
The parking spots, some of them, if you were in it, you couldn't get out because the car beside you would block you.
They gave that as an illustration for the purposes of zoning, but they will have to submit construction documents for the parking lot.
Yeah. So y'all will review the actual parking lot.
Yes, sir.
And it will work.
Yes, sir.
I'm in favor of the zoning change. I did that parking lot design just blows my mind.
The next item, 5B, is a resolution to support the construction of the westbound and eastbound I-20 frontage roads on North Main Camp Lisbon Road. This is a project that the TxDOT had the public hearing in December, and as stated at that public hearing, they were waiting on the city council to make the decision on the construction of those service roads. As we listed in the agenda memo, we had information in there concerning traffic counts and pedestrian counts.
I noticed Wednesday that Signs and Signals was out taking some additional counts, or will they be available tonight?
I don't have them tonight, sir. We were going to take them this entire week. I don't have them yet.
And then item 5C is a resolution establishing the Duncanville Sister City Commission. This was after the discussion that we had with you previously about creating a Sister City Commission. This commission is established with 5 members, and with the purpose being to coordinate and support relationships between Duncanville and Monticello de Saviano. Based on the discussion that we had with you previously, the commission is set up, as I mentioned, with 5 members. There is no residency requirement on that because some of those some of the people that have been involved in that in the past are still wanting to serve and do not necessarily live in Duncanville. There is no term limit on those.
I'd like to pull this and have some more talking about it because I got 2 people from your district that called me about what in the world, saying that 5 people that can, as they said, the czars can stay on there for life, and they don't have to live here. And money, we never talked about money coming out of the general fund. You know, the way it was going was one way, but this is outrageous.
There's not, what money are you talking about?
Well, it says money in general fund.
That would be if there was anything that was approved, but if this is an advisory body, so if there was anything that they recommended and the council approved, it would come out of the general fund.
We had 2 people that sat at our table the night we had the dinner, and they made the comments at the table, "Do you still live in Duncanville?" And I thought, excuse me? You're in Duncanville? It is Duncanville? It was a sister city with Duncanville? I don't understand where this is going when we make committees and say that the people don't need to live in Duncanville.
This was a discussion item before, and
we never said that people didn't have to live in Duncanville.
Taking the direction from the council from that discussion, it is up to y'all what you want to do with this commission.
I would never support something where the committee members didn't need to live in Duncanville, for a committee of Duncanville to be Duncanville city, sister city.
Well, there's a lot of people who have been involved in this, John. For instance, we have one couple, they're both, one of them's a doctor, they've lived in Duncanville all the way through, and they recently downsized their huge house.
I know, and they live at the country club.
And moved over to, and that's where the mayor stayed when he was here the other, put back in March.
They can still participate, it's being on the committee. And you, it's your choice to move out of Duncanville if you want to. But this is a Duncanville sister city, it's a Duncanville committee.
There's as many people support the project living outside Duncanville. Used to be there was more than lived in Duncanville.
And that's great, then don't have a committee in Duncanville. Do it the way you were doing it before, where y'all just got together and the city, we had dinner and song. But it doesn't need to be a formal process like this with people that don't live in Duncanville to have a sister city. And I'm telling you, the things that were said at the table, in fact, they said them also, my daughter was appalled. She was like, what, could you hear them? I said, yes. So it was like everybody's left, but y'all are still here? I will never support a committee for the city and say that you don't have to live here to be on our committee. Do you think they would do that in Plano or Richardson or McKinney? No. Or Flower Mound? Absolutely not. That's crazy.
This is not a board of commission. This is an ad hoc committee for a
Then don't make it formal. Just have it like it was.
Maybe that'd be.
No. Just do it like you were doing it. It was fine. It doesn't need to have a name and a committee and a City of Duncanville committee.
We're running tight on time tonight. Let's pull that one. We'll have a meeting where we can sit down and discuss it further.
That's all the items on the agenda.
We've got two briefing items. Item number two on the field house and the TIF board is going to take approximately the length of time that we have left before we go into the meeting at 7. So what I'm going to ask to do is to go ahead and have these two, and we will move the executive session until immediately after the council meeting, and we'll come back in here for the executive session. That need everybody's approval? Okay. All right, item number two, briefing presentations. Item number eight, discussion of the potential naming rights sponsors for the Duncanville Fieldhouse.
Thank you, Mayor and Council. I'll give a brief introduction. I'm going to turn the program over to the Maidens and then to Westfield. The city for quite some time has discussed revenue opportunities for the field house, and naming rights is one of those opportunities. We have been in some preliminary discussions with a group for several months now. We thought now is the time to come before you and give you some information about those discussions and get your feedback. So with that, I want to introduce Terrence and Tim Maiden with Rides.
Well, good evening, everyone. Appreciate you having us on this cold and wet Tuesday. I'm Terrence Maiden, my identical brother, Tim. We, as Bart mentioned, been having several conversations about the idea of the naming rights for the field house. And what we did was put together about a 12 to 15 minute presentation about Rise Company and who we are and our background. So, appreciate just sharing tonight. Thank you for having us again. Instead of doing a formal introduction, what we thought we would do is share a video that was aired on WFAA with Shaping DFW with Cadillac, which really gives a background about our upbringing and what we've been doing over the course of our careers.
Our goal is to
represent
our have some level of success professionally, but there's still people behind you that's either not in or out, but end up. It's really frustrating when you have some event and someone walks up to you and says, "I didn't want to be proud." Until it's made, until made, people know there's a made to this. Tim and I grew up in the Oak Cliff area of Dallas. It was very humble beginnings. He was a very close-knit family. A lot of our peers gravitated to our home a lot. People felt really comfortable. My mom cooked for the entire neighborhood. When you looked at the fabric of the community that we grew up in, there were a lot of challenges. But we've seen a lot. You know, shootings, gang activity, drug dealing. We were exposed to all those different things. And we began to play sports together. We felt like even if football wasn't in our future, we were going to go to college. I think our parents just really inspired us to want to make more out of our lives. Carter growing up for us was a powerhouse, and it's featured in Friday Night Lights from 1988 to about 2000. There were a number of great athletes that came out of our program. A rise that has contributed to Coach Freddie James is the one that Benjamin should strongly consider TCU. He felt like he did very well. And when we finished our senior year, we took some time off to kind of reflect on really what we want to do at the NFL. It's in the future for us, and for us, we thought the best decision is to focus on our business careers. Carefully, I'm Senior Vice President for Frost Bank. I was their first hire when Frost came to Southern Dallas. When a financial institution decides to plant 5 or 6 branches in Southern Dallas, it's a great feeling. Not only do you invest capital into a community, but you also develop great jobs and career opportunities. I'm the Executive Vice President at Cleveland Properties. We've actually developed over 3 million square feet of shopping centers south of downtown. Growing up, it was an I-35 new prevalent that is the community we grew up in. Before we were able to land Walmart, there was really a forest, just 4 trees and a lot of tires. The evolution of the development brings a very deep sense of pride. There is no 300 to 500 jobs just created by this one development. People are going to work, they're hiring within the community. Our mom passed away in 2008 of cancer, so it's right on the cusp of us starting the foundation. When we watched 2 wins, we felt the need to really give back because we were so fortunate to gain a lot of experience at TCU. It was established in 2005. And our motto is build a community and change a life. But we discovered the major difference between the disenfranchised and the fluent is education and career exposure. If we could bridge that gap, if we could get our young students more educated and focused on college, and also start thinking about their careers early on. We've taken roughly 315 students on our road to success. It's just a field trip, but it's more experience than you have an opportunity to see different careers. Once you generate the purpose in their heart, then you begin to transform the lives of the students. So that's our goal, is to create an excitement, a desire, and inspire them to want more, to expect more. Our original vision is looking more funders at organizations like the YMCA. The one that's most near and dear to our hearts is the Oak Cliff YMCA. Where we learn how to swim, we learn how to be competitive. It was a major investment, and there's a lot of things that happen to become a catalyst for change, starting with taking the gymnasium and partitioning off and creating a weight room. We also added windows to open it up so we could get the sunlight in there. We increased the size of the kitchen area where the kids and students could have a place where they could come in and color and do arts and crafts. But I think the lounge area is kind of like the hallmark of the center. There's an opportunity for fellowship. There's a certain table that's designated just for the ladies to engage in conversation. Sometimes they don't even work out, but they just go just for the fellowship. And knowing that you had a part in that really means a lot. In order for the city of Dallas to elevate that really second Dallas, I need to take that next step too. It's tough to ask people outside of the community to help and to give. If you're not committed to make that investment, we want to be on the front line. We want to be trans, engaged in the community. We believe that so when much is given, much is required. So we would need to commit an extra step and an extra mile to make a difference, because at the end of the day, that's who we are.
So we appreciate, I know that was lengthy, but we appreciate you taking the opportunity just to kind of hear a little bit about us. Again, we grew up in Dallas. Tim resides in the city of Duncanville. I feel like I'm in Duncanville. I'm right at 67 in Maine. So we actually still, you know, we're close to the city. We live in the area. Went to TCU. I'm in real estate development, development shopping centers. Tim is in banking. We want to share kind of our journey to RISE. There's a lot of things that led up to this opportunity, something that, you know, really bridges our passion and our experience, and something that we've been talking about for much of our lives, is to kind of find the right opportunity to work together on a project that was unique. We launched Two Winds Foundation in 2005. We started our investment company in 2001. And I don't want to go through every deal point, but there just highlight a couple of major accomplishments. 2015, we celebrated our 10-year anniversary of the foundation and really invested, you know, thousands of dollars into inner city communities and with various projects. Also in 2015, we were inducted into the TCU Hall of Fame. In regards to the RISE Clothing was based out of Cincinnati, Ohio. It was founded in 2011 by a guy by the name of Noah Heller. He invested approximately $1 million into designing and manufacturing the product. In 2012, Noah sold it to a gentleman named Ian and Monica. That's who we spent our time negotiating with back in 2012 when we started our discussions with the RISE company about the potential acquisition and bringing the company to Dallas. The interesting thing about the company is that it was initially branded a poker line, and so Noah Heller was heavily involved in kind of the gaming of poker. And when Ian and Monica acquired the company, they tried to rebrand it to more of an urban sort of look. And when we acquired it, we wanted to transition it to more of an athleisure brand with a very inspirational message undertone. So now we could talk a little bit more about the company. Again, now we're headquartered in Dallas. We believe people can feel good, look good, and do good, and that's what our brand mission is really about. You know, we focus on a smart athletic clothing brand, you know, that's trendy and that really is attractive to more millennials. So our target demographic is more high school, college age. So here's our mission. It's really to deliver a high quality product that is branded to inspire and engage while, you know, being socially impactful. Now, here are some of our brand promises, and then also our vision is to motivate and inspire people through our brand and a powerful message to RISE. Since we acquired the company and relaunched it in 2015, we've received quite a bit of press. It's been a great opportunity. We're on the cover of a couple of magazines. Actually, D Magazine has a concept online magazine called Dallas Innovates, and we were the top story in 2016, and also we had over 90,000 readers for the one that they released this year. This is the fashion show from when we launched in last year. So we had about 250-300 people out for the official relaunch as a Dallas company. So the look, our inventory right now is primarily tees, hoodies, white hoodies, and jackets. We actually have some sample products here that we can spread around if someone wants to take a look at it, but it's primarily athletic leisure wear. Right now, we have about 5,800 tees in inventory, about 3,000 hoodies, 1,200 jackets, about 6,000 caps. There are some more products over there, too, that we could share. So what have we been doing as a company since we made the acquisition back in 2015? Well, one is that we assembled a really solid team to assist with design, manufacturing here locally. We have a strong PR team, videography, and then also web design group. So over the course of the last 18 months, we've been doing heavy promotions with our online e-commerce business. We actually shipped all the inventory to Dallas, and we have a logistics company that's here local. We shut down the company online and redid the entire website. We've also been reaching out to high-profile celebrities. The young man in the black on the bottom row is Eddie Winslow from Family Matters, who has been really wearing our product a lot. We also had the fashion show, which we just showed, and then creating a series of inspirational films that we've been sending out to the market. Our logistics partner is On Target. They're located in Oak Cliff, South Dallas, right south of downtown. The picture to the top left is a photo of all of our inventory that's in stock. So they're really responsible for our online placement and getting the products into people's hands. Here's another video of an example commercial that we recently launched online.
Matter
of
style said, we are what we repeatedly do. Excellence, then, is not an act, but a habit. Life's battles don't always go to the stronger and faster man. Sooner or later, the man who wins is the man who thinks he can. You want to be the best. You want to rise. Everybody wants the championship. Everybody wants to start. Starting is easy. If you want to succeed, you have to be your own hero, my friend. Finishing requires will. It requires commitment. Sacrifice. It's no secret. We're going to fall down. We'll get pushed. You'll land square on your face. But every time that happens, you get back on your feet. Ground is no place for a champion. He who says he can, and he who says he can, are both usually right. Get up. We're all in. Rise.
So that gives you an example of some of the commercial advertisement we've been doing for the brand, again, online. But it has really helped us gain a lot of momentum, especially through social media. So we, as a company, we have three main things. It's the look. So we try to design apparel in the brand that really resonates with the millennials. So we have the inventory that we talked about, but we're also, we'll be rolling out 8 new items this year. So we're trying to keep up with the trends and what people are wearing, in particular the high school and college age students. But what I think differentiates us from our competition is this component, is the feel. We want people to wear our brand, but also feel good wearing it. So with that, we've created a platform where we try to inspire people with very inspirational storylines and messages, and particularly from high-profile people that would share how their journey to rising above their circumstances to success. The gentleman on the page at the bottom is LaDainian Tomlinson, will be in all likelihood an NFL Hall of Famer this year, and was an all-pro running back in NFL. So where we take these messages and we use social media, Facebook, Instagram, Twitter, also is housed on our Inspire to Rise website. And then we have a very strong media team to help us this will give you, this next clip will give you an example of the inspirational films that we put together. It's real quick, but it shows, you know, LaDainian Thomas's journey.
Sometimes when you're depressed and down and you feel like there's nowhere to go, what I've always done is told them my story of my struggles. And just to be honest, everyone has a struggle. Everyone does. No one is perfect. You know, the spirit in us, it shouldn't allow us to quit ever. It just shouldn't.
Although that was a quick clip, he has his full story that's on our website if anybody wants to check out the 5-minute story, but we just did that as more of a commercial clip. And this gives you an example of a lot of relationships that we have with professional coaches, college coaches, professional athletes, college athletes, the different universities in the across Dallas-Fort Worth. And then lastly, it's so you have the look, you have the feel, and you have the do. And the do is more so we as an organization, as a company, wanted to make sure that we was always socially conscious. And the big thing for us is the area of poverty and giving back as a company. So we've committed 8% of our revenue sales to go to alleviate poverty. These are just some statistics with the poverty level in Dallas, but we also see this as an opportunity not to reach the world in efforts to alleviate poverty. So at our fashion show, we make a grant to one or two organizations that are really rallying to alleviate poverty, whether locally or nationally. And again, 8% of our sales would go towards that mission. So we just wanted to cast a vision. I know we're here tonight to talk about the potential name and rights of the Bob Knight Fieldhouse, Duncanville Fieldhouse, and we can, just more vision casting on what could be. And that's our presentation. Is there any questions that we can answer? I know we ran through that pretty quick. Again, yeah, thank you for having us.
Thank you.
Mayor, Kevin, Council, thank you for the opportunity tonight to be here to share with you our prospective naming rights sponsor, Rise and the Maiden Twins. I was fortunate enough to meet these guys about 3 months ago, and over a series of probably 20, 30 meetings, we've come to tonight, and we feel like we've put together a strong proposal to present to the group to change the naming of the field house into two individuals that are local and have passion for this community. And I couldn't be prouder to be a part of it. We'll run through this real quick. It's a 5-year deal. We're going to revisit it after 4 years to reflect and see where we've been and where we're going to hopefully lead it into the future for an additional term to be determined. Some key points is there will be no keys and access to anyone other than city employees, so the sponsor will not have any keys. Also, all mail will be delivered to a post office box, which would make their mail and any incoming mail be much more secure. kind of nuts and bolts. $35,000 of their total investment will go toward the sign replacements. I think there's a budget of $140,000 that's been discussed to change all the Bob Knight likeness out and replace. There's a commitment of $35,000 to put toward that to support our efforts. We'll work together on developing a logo that everyone has comfort level with, which will include the Duncanville name as a presence. Part of their plan is, which is so great about this deal, it's not only a naming sponsor for the facility, but it also generates additional revenue with the fine clothing line that was presented tonight that gives a great inspirational message. And 100% of those garments and merchandise will be funded by the sponsor. They're going to be responsible for the merchandise fixtures, the display, setting it up, coming in basically doing 100% of all the make-ready costs to make it happen, and also offer on big events like GASO and our bigger events. They will have staff on site to help replace the inventory, as well as act as salespeople to help our staff get it out the door and replace. Their online merchandising will mirror what we're doing here at the Fieldhouse. There's the same photo that was shown in the presentation that lists the word Duncanville under the Fieldhouse for the presence of the city. Benefits to the sponsor, we're going to provide a locker room somewhere in the facility. Their main logistical area will stay in place over in Dallas, but we will have a smaller area to be a platform to have merchandise on site that can go to the display area and just replenish as it's sold. We will have the sponsor and myself and our staff will be the only one to have access to the room for security. And we're going to offer a small cubicle for meetings and to have a make-do office for Rise within the field house that will only be accessible when the building's open. Kind of the money on the deal, the annual naming rights fees total $250,000 over 5 years. At a minimum, the $25,000 will be guaranteed money against the souvenir merchandise sales. If we hit our projected number, that number can grow, which is more value to the city. Their corporate headquarters will be listed here as in Duncanville, so any sales at all on their online efforts we benefit from through a local sales tax. Hopefully, with their contacts and the ability in the community that we're going to host several events that would be sponsored by Rise, and none of those fees that are being paid are included in this deal, so they would be viewed as any other renter at the facility and pay a rate card price to rent the facility for those events. Here's a little make-do budget here. Sign replacement, $35,000. Naming rights, $250,000. Profit sharing on the merchandise, $25,000. Estimated sales tax, $10,000. So the benefit of the city over a five-year period is $325,000. Additions in the future. There are also some discussions about you know, sales is about relationships and what great relationships these guys have in the community and their personal lives, and they're willing to bring those to the table to help our efforts in naming other sponsors within the building. Those discussions are separate from this agreement, as well as potentially bringing in other entities to lease the facility, which will be named at a later date. And all those will be obviously brought to council and be approved on an individual basis. And that's that. If there's any questions, I'll do my best to try to answer between myself or Tim Tex.
Given your professional experience in working with sports facilities, how do you compare this to things that you've experienced before in your career? How does this measure up?
As far as the financial aspect of a naming facility?
Financial, operational, possibilities in the future?
Operational, it doesn't come close to what having people, normally when you have a naming sponsor, it's a corporate business, it's only focused on getting your name out in the community and as a marketing tool. This is so much bigger than that. These guys are, live in the community, are invested in the community, there's a merchandise component to it that will be bringing events to us, so I think as far as operational, it's far away and a better. Financially, I tried to look up and find some facilities similar to the field house that would give us a barometer of where it is, and I found one that's similar. It's a city-owned facility in South Haven, Mississippi, their deal in the first 5 years is $500,000. That facility opened in 2000. A little bit different. It has a $1.8 million video board in the building. It seats 10,000 people and has a pro hockey team as a tenant. So it's, comparatively speaking, we're in the ballpark. To answer your question, financially, we're in the ballpark. Operationally, we're ahead of the game.
Meaton Brothers, I'm just curious. You guys probably could have went anywhere in the country to do this sort of thing. Why Duncanville?
It's home. Yeah, we feel, we've looked at the field house on many occasions. We, with our relationship, as Craig mentioned, we believe that it's a great opportunity to leverage a lot of our relationships locally. We feel good to bring rise to Duncanville. We feel like it's a good fertile ground, you know, with everything that's happening in the city and the investment that the city has already made in the field house. We just think the timing is great. So that's really it. It's home. I mean, literally, like, we both live 2 minutes away. So I know it can be something that we can just really nurture and grow.
Yeah, and I think also to add to Terrence, our aspiration is to increase, I know it's done great, got a very strong name in other markets, college ball, basketball tournaments. We're bringing more exposure to professional athletes so they can come in, not only to see just basketball, but maybe some academic center, seeing what it's offering to the community, just make it a special place, just leverage, this platform that we have with the clothing company and the Fieldhouse Athletics to really do something really unique.
I just think it's a wonderful thing to be able to grow up in a community and then really establish yourself there and be able to experience the entirety of your life in the community in which you grew up in. I'm originally from New Orleans, and sometimes I wonder what it would be like if situation was different for me and I was still there, what my life would be like. So it's an awesome thing to be able to have that experience, and I'm certainly impressed with the fact that you guys are so committed to what you're doing and what you've done already, and you want to take it to the next level with this community. So I'm excited about the possibilities of partnering with you.
Thank you.
I just want to say that I followed them. They've been in the papers and stuff. I've read about them. But they have young people come back and settle in their community and get back. That's what I preach to my kids and the kids who will listen to me. And I'm just so thankful that we have this example to show off. And maybe the synergy and then we'll keep it going.
Terrence has been involved with the redo of Redbird Mall, too. I mean, these are hometown voters. Tim lives a few houses down from me.
Oh, we won't hold that against
him. He's my neighbor.
Well, Mayor and Council, we wanted to bring this to you. As Craig said, he's been working with Tim and Terrence for several months on this, and we're at the point where we wanted to bring this to you to make sure that y'all were comfortable with it, What we will do is finalize these into a contract and agreement, and then we'll come back for council approval.
Sorry, I think we need to have a discussion, but maybe an executive session, because this is about...
Yeah, when it's on the council agenda, you can go into executive session on any item on the agenda. So if you want to do that, you can. I think this is a really good opportunity. I'm very excited about it. I think as all the things that were said, you know, the Maidens are part of this community. Certainly have a vested interest in seeing the field house successful, and I think they will also bring a lot of prestige to the field house. They're well-known, well-respected in the community, and I think that will serve us very well also. So we're really excited to see this coming forward.
Okay, thank you very much. Any further questions before we move on to the next item? We're just barely on time here. Item 2B is to discuss and receive direction from City Council regarding this TIF board member selection process.
Thank you, Mayor. Honorable Mayor and Council, as you know, on December 20th, the Council approved creating the first tax increment financing reinvestment zone, or a TIF. And with that, also, you approved the creation of a five-member board. So I'm here tonight to ask you how the council, or get direction on how the council would like to handle the creation of the board. A couple things to highlight. The board members do not have to have a business nor live in the TIF zone. They just have to be a resident of the Duncanville community. So there's a couple options that the council can think about and then maybe provide a little guidance on. First of all, the council can choose to review the current applicants on hand and possibly select from that group. They can also decide to hold new interviews of new potential members. In addition, they can appoint one of the EDC board members, which is something that I know that the board would like to see. And then also, the council could opt to just every council member possibly provide one name, and then the council could decide and vote on the individual names that way. So really, I'm here tonight to ask for guidance from you all and see what direction you would like to do.
Did you mention the deadline that we had on time?
Oh, I apologize. Yes, and because of the, we have 60 days basically from December 20th. So you do have, I spoke with our consultant, and we could extend it until February 21st, which would give you basically 61 days. And that way you would have a little bit more time to decide what direction you'd like to go, or hold interviews if necessary.
Number of members?
Five members.
Okay.
So if you had five members, then you're saying that five council people could submit a name?
All the council members actually could submit a name, and then the council could vote as a group in terms of selecting which ones they would like to have on the board.
I'm comfortable with submitting names. I think we know our volunteers. We have applications from the boards and commissions.
Well, we need to start over. This is different. Not just people that were on the other one. It's a totally different thing.
The person that I'm thinking about, I've already talked to him, and he's interested in it, and I think it would be a good idea. But, and so that's why I'm suggesting that, because I don't want to have someone in mind. But if the council chooses to go another way, I'll just have him go, I'll just channel him that way.
Well, out of the five members, I would be much in favor of having one member of the EDC on there, and we can talk about that coming up, and that would be four others. So.
Okay,
what if we had one from each district?
That'd be too many. That'd be an unruly board. If you, that would make it to five or six, five, unless you want to
whoever we chose from the EDC, wherever he lives, that could be that district person.
It's up to y'all. I mean, you can have as many members as you want, but you don't want to get it too large, or you, it doesn't function very well. And after all, everything they decide has got to be submitted to the council.
I just think being the first time we've done this, it may be good to have one representative from each district, so it's an all-city effort.
Whatever the council wants.
The mayor mentioned that you could go to seven if you wanted to. The ordinance was created and established it at five, so if you want to go to seven, we would have to bring the ordinance back for revision. But if you wanted to do that, I would not recommend going over seven.
If one from each district could just be five.
Right.
But then if you wanted to put one from the EDC, you'd have to.
It depends on where he lives.
Yeah.
If he lives in District One.
Yeah.
The other four would come.
He'd have to live from, no, he wouldn't necessarily. Do they have to reside in Duncanville?
Yes.
Okay, all right. Okay, so that could be possible there. Okay, direction, that's what she's asking for.
One from each district.
So y'all will bring nominations then back to, or?
When do you want the nominations in? Wait 10 days, plenty of time to work on it.
Can we send it to Mary?
Beg your pardon?
Email it to Mary?
Yeah, that'd be all right. And let's put 10 days from today, which would be 29. Do it by the 29. Okay?
How do we decide?
Yeah, you'll receive, and then they have to be in by the 29. In the next council meeting after that, let's.
The February 7th agenda, we'll put an item in on there, and it'll just essentially have five blanks, and then y'all can decide who you want to put in it.
Is that okay?
How do we decide who from the EDC? How are we going to pick a member from the EDC?
Then we get to say they want to do it.
And you might think about, we do have a president and a vice president. So sometimes, you know, those are good options to go with as well. Oh, yes, and they would be willing to. Yes, I'm sorry.
That would be number one.
Yes.
Okay. All right, anything further discussed about that? Okay, you got your direction? Okay. All right, what I'm going to do is recess this meeting at 6:57. We will open the council meeting, and after we finish with our business in council, so open this meeting up again to go into executive session, and we will dismiss from executive session. We'll dismiss the executive session and then close the meeting in here. Is that okay?
As long as there's no action after executive session, that works.
Yeah. The meeting to order. Our first order of business tonight will be our invocation by Pastor Frank Algeria from the First United Methodist Church, Duncanville, Texas. Frank? Following that, we'll have our Pledge of Allegiance to the flag, so will you please stand at this time?
Let's pray. Almighty, gracious, loving, and kind God, we thank you, Lord, for another day of life. We thank you, Lord, for the city council and everyone that's been elected to serve and those appointed. Lord, they have a great responsibility, and so we ask for your blessings upon them, wisdom and guidance. Collaboration. Because at the end, Lord, it's an entrustment issue. You've entrusted this council and all its responsibilities, Lord, to them. We need help. They need help. Because we want to live in a nation and a community where there is love and there's peace, but also, Lord, where there's safety and there's concern. It's a place where we can raise children and have grandchildren come and live the next.
Amen.
I pledge the allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all. Honor the Texas flag. I pledge the allegiance to thee, Texas, one state, under God, one and indivisible.
My mayor's report tonight is going to be what's going to be happening this Saturday from 8 o'clock to 2 o'clock. It's now time for our monthly festival that we have down on Main Street. It's a great show. Right now the weatherman is saying that we're going to have some pretty decent weather, but I think that's subject to change knowing weather in January in Duncanville, Texas. But we invite all of you to come out for our Duncan Switch, which will be held this Saturday from 8 to 2 on Main Street. So we hope to see you there. Council member reports. Do we have any tonight? Seeing none, we'll move right along. City manager's report. Oh, I'm sorry.
I'd just like to give a big thank you to the public, to the Parks Recreation Department. On Saturday, 10 of us that are involved with Keep Duncanville Beautiful went on a litter survey ride for 3 hours looking at litter across the city. Four of us were on the trip last year, and it was a remarkable difference this year. The new litter crew has done a fantastic job, so I just want to say kudos to the Parks Recreation Department.
Dr. Dotson, is your light on? We need to have these checked. Your light to speak. Yeah. There it is. Okay, I just wanted to make sure that our light system was working. City manager's report.
Thank you, Mayor and Council. I would like to mention that tomorrow night we have a first community input meeting for the Parks Master Planning process, and that will be at 6 o'clock at the D.L. Hopkins Junior Senior Center. And then there will also be another opportunity next Tuesday, same time, 6 o'clock. So if you can come out to one of those meetings, please come, and the consultants and staff will be there, and we seek the community's input on the future planning of our parks system. So please come out to the center. Thank you.
Item number 3 is the citizens input period, and several of you have signed a card saying you want to comment on the proclamation. Missed that one entirely. Item number 2 is a proclamation recognizing Martin Luther King Jr. Day, which is January the 16th, 2017. I've asked Councilman Patrick Harvey to read that proclamation, and I would invite Mary Faye Cam to come up and receive it.
Thank you, Mayor. Whereas the Reverend Dr. Martin Luther King Jr., who was born on January 15, 1929, dedicated his life to the advancement of civil rights and public service, and whereas Dr. King believed in a nation of freedom and justice for all through nonviolent means, and challenged all citizens to help build a more perfect union and live up to the purpose and potential of America, and whereas federal and state legislatures have recognized Dr. King's legacy as one of America's outstanding civil rights leaders by creating a federal holiday marking his birthday, and whereas this federal holiday was signed into law in 1983 and first observed in 1986, making 2017 the 31st anniversary of the nationwide observance of the Martin Luther King Jr. federal holiday, and whereas Dr. King's legacy is honored each year on the third Monday in January. Now therefore, David L. Green, mayor of the city of Duncanville, Texas, hereby proclaims January 16, 2017, as Dr. Martin Luther King Day in the city of Duncanville, and urge all citizens to join together in honoring and remembering Dr. King for his humanitarian values and dedication to make America one nation with equity and justice for all.
Ms. Kim, would you like to respond?
Thank you. I gladly accept this on behalf of the Board of Trustees for the International Museum of Cultures. We joined the city of Duncanville in promoting inclusion across our area, and we have finished our last year with over 25,000 visitors, and any of our tours that have docents, they are always told that this is a city of inclusion. So we appreciate your input by honoring Dr. King with this.
Item number three is our citizen input period. We have five cards, and they all say that they would like to speak on the I-20 service road. So does anybody want to come up and speak now, or would you prefer to speak when item number 5B comes up for consideration? Does anybody want to speak now? Okay, we'll defer these cards until we get to item number 5B. Item number four is our consent agenda. They are items A through I. So at this time, I will ask the city secretary to read the captions on those.
Four A, consider the minutes for the December 20, 2016 regular city council meeting. Four B, consider a resolution of the city council of the city of Duncanville, Texas, authorizing the procurement of emergency medical supplies from Bound Tree Medical Products, Inc. through the City of Cedar Hill contract number 19-0-2013 for the unit price bid with an estimated annual expenditure of $60,500, authorizing the city manager to execute the necessary documents and providing an effective date. Item 4C, consider a resolution of the City Council of the City of Duncanville, Texas, authorizing the annual procurement of hot mix asphalt with Austin Asphalt LP in the unit amount bid through the City of Dallas agreement number BQ1529 with an estimated annual expenditure of $67,493, authorizing the city manager to execute the necessary documents and providing for an effective date. Item 4D, consider a resolution of the City Council of the City of Duncanville, Texas, rejecting all bids for IFB number 17-11, North Main Street Phase 2 Emergency Generator, Water Quality Improvements, and Variable Frequency Drive, providing for appropriate notice, providing authorization to rebid, and providing for an effective date. Item 4E, consider a resolution of the City Council of the City of Duncanville, Texas, to award a term contract for IFB number 17-15, pavement marking supply and installation services, for the unit prices bid to Action Commercial Services LLC of Rockwell, Texas, and the unit amount bid for an estimated amount of $76,708, authorizing the city manager to execute necessary documents and or purchase orders, providing a repealing clause, and providing an effective date. 4F, consider a resolution of the City Council of the City of Duncanville, Texas, authorizing the County of Dallas to resell a tax foreclosed property struck off to the City of Duncanville as trustee by public or private sale as authorized by Section 34.05 of the Texas Property Code, commonly known as 4 Belmont Place, authorizing city manager to execute the necessary documents and providing for an effective date. 4G, consider a resolution of the City Council of the City of Duncanville, Texas, authorizing Linebarger, Goggin, Blair, and Sampson, LLP, to authorize an order of sale which will allow for the foreclosure and to authorize the sale of the properties by Dallas County at public or private sale in accordance with Section 34.05 of the Texas Property Tax Code for the following properties: 1311 South Cockrell Hill, 414 Rock Rose Drive, 1204 Crest Lane Drive, 603 Woodhaven Boulevard, 141 Greystone Place, authorizing the city manager to execute the necessary documents and providing for an effective date. 4H, consider a resolution of the City of Council of the City of Duncanville, Texas, to award a bid and approve a contract for IFB 17-07 FY 2017 Water and Wastewater Improvements, attached as Exhibit A to Raytech Services LLC, in the amount of $518,078.65, authorizing city manager to execute such agreement and providing an effective date. 4I, consider a resolution of the City Council of the City of Duncanville, Texas, authorizing the first of 2 1-year renewal options for term contract number 16-11, Traffic Signal Maintenance Services to Simons Industry, Inc., in the same unit amounts, with an estimated annual expenditure amount of $131,950, authorizing city manager to execute the necessary documents and providing for an effective date.
Council, you've heard the captions read. The chair will entertain a motion.
I move we approve the items as read.
Second.
There's a motion and a second. There is no discussion, so please vote. Okay, thank you. Item number 5A is to conduct a public hearing and consider an ordinance of the City of Duncanville, Texas, amending the comprehensive zoning ordinance and map as heretofore mentioned by granting a change in zoning from R1.4 single family dwelling residential zoning to NR neighborhood retail zoning, Lot 1, Block B, Doris Heights, more commonly known as 243 West Vineyard Road, in the City of Duncanville, Dallas County, Texas, and being more particularly described as Exhibit A, attached hereto and incorporated herein, providing a repealing clause, providing a savings clause, providing a severability clause, providing a penalty of fine not to exceed the sum of $2,000 for each offense, and providing an effective date. Now, I want to remind you, this is a public hearing. So at this time, we will call on staff to give us a briefing.
Good evening, Mayor and Council. Chastity Allen, City Planner. The request before you tonight is a request for a change of zoning from R1.4 single family residential to neighborhood retail. The purpose is to rezone the property for the development of a parking lot to service the property at 242 West Wheatland Road. Just a little background, the subject property was rezoned from R3 to R1.4 back in 2002 as a part of a citywide rezoning effort. That also included rezoning of some properties along Wheatland Road, which rezoned those properties to neighborhood retail. The subject property never developed, however, it is adjacent to a developed property, as I mentioned, at 242 West Wheatland, which was once occupied with a photography studio. That building is approximately 4,500 square feet. There's only 11 existing parking spaces on the subject, on the 242 West Wheatland. And so in order for the property to be redeveloped and reused for a hair salon, the applicant is proposing to rezone the subject property to allow for additional parking spaces. I will note that the parking required for many uses that could occupy that building would require additional parking outside of the existing 11 spaces. So whether this was occupied by a hair salon or any other use, the parking would need to be added to make that building more functional. I would note that plans for the parking lot and landscaping, should this request be approved, would be reviewed by staff prior to issuance of any permits. The applicant would also be required to replat the property into one lot. Currently, it is two lots. And so should the zoning be approved, they would replat it into one lot. The properties immediately to the east are zoned, and to the south across West Vineyard are zoned residential and are developed with single-family homes. Properties to the northwest across Peach Street is developed with the assisted living facility. If the property is rezoned, they will be required to comply with the neighborhood retail district standards, including but not limited to a masonry screening wall along the eastern property line, which borders the residential property. Of course, you know, anytime that you are rezoning property from within a residential area, you want to consider the impact to that area. Should be noted that, as I stated previously, there is some neighborhood retail immediately adjacent to the existing single family. I'll go to the zoning map here. As you can see in the yellow, that property is zoned neighborhood retail. Properties to the south of that are zoned residential. So they already abut neighborhood retail in that area. And so this would introduce neighborhood retail on the property at 243. This is just an aerial. It's very difficult to see, but the property is undeveloped. This is a illustrative site plan showing how potentially the parking would be provided along Vineyard on the subject property. As we indicated, the applicant would be required to submit plans, and they would have to comply with all of our standards. Planning and Zoning Commission did unanimously recommend approval of the rezoning. We did receive one letter of opposition, which I believe was included in your packet. The applicant, Mr. Evans, is present if you all have any additional questions.
Thank you very much. Now, I do want to remind you this is a public hearing. So at this time, I will ask anybody who would like to speak either for or against to please come up, give your name and address so that the secretary may record it, and then speak your opposition or approval for this. This is your chance. Seeing none, chair will entertain a motion to close the public hearing.
Did she say that the person was here?
But they didn't want to come up.
Yes.
Looking to lease it out, having a 4,500 square foot building that's spaces are usable, but the entire facility is not usable because it will require more parking. And so I saw the lot right behind it was vacant. It was bankrupt. I worked a long time with Lineberger, I think it is. They kept me updated on the process along with Jessica James. And so I was encouraged to go to the auction, buy the land, because otherwise, I guess we would have to wait on someone to build on it for their dream home, but it would be better for me to be able to use that lot as a parking lot and put a masonry wall there and kind of make it inclusive to the assisted living facility that was just built right next door. So I think it would be good for me, for my business to be able to be used there, and also for the city. It would just look a lot better than an undeveloped residential lot. So that's my argument for it.
Mr. Evans, would you give your full name and address for the city secretary?
Jonathan Blake Evans, and address of the building?
Well, or your residence.
Residence, 2960 North Camino Lagos, Grand Prairie, Texas, 75054.
Okay, thank you, sir.
Thank you.
Chair will entertain a motion to close the public hearing.
Close
hearing.
Motion and a second. Will you please vote? Okay, thank you very much. Council, the chair will entertain a motion to whatever.
Thank you, Mayor. I move that we approve this request as submitted.
I second.
There's a motion and a second. Is there any further questions, discussion? Seeing none, will you please vote? Thank you. I'm going to skip back to item number three because I received a card after we had closed out the citizen input. It's somebody who would like to speak on something besides the I-20 service road, so I'll call Mr. Thomas Lackey. It's on.
It's on. Well, thank you for letting me speak about this. I just happened to see on the website on the December meeting there was quite a lot of discussion about the widening of US 67.
Mr. Lackey, will you give your name and address
to the Thomas Secretary? Lackey, 1818 Seabrook. And so it just occurred to me when I was, you know, kind of going through that discussion, you know, with the logo and all that stuff. Since one of the capstones is to increase our presence as a destination for athleticism, I'd just like to get it in everybody's thoughts, I guess, about a pedestrian bridge or a bicycle bridge across 67 between Daniel Dale and Main Street. That's it.
Thank you, sir. All right, I'm going to open up the citizens' input on the I-20 service roads at this time before we move forward with the consideration of the resolution. The first card I've got is Brad Toops.
Hello, Mayor, City Council members. My name is Brad Toops. I live at 1219 Ridge Rock Lane here in Duncanville. I would like, as you consider item 5B, to consider adopting a resolution supporting TxDOT's requirements to construct an eastbound access road only, not to support the construction of the westbound access road. Thank you very much.
Thank you, sir. Nancy Bell. Is that other mic not on?
Yes.
It's not on? Okay, all right.
Nancy Bell, 938 Nature Drive, Duncanville. Good evening, Council. My issue is the vote on the I-20 service roads. It is evident that the majority of this council is for this major project because it does not affect your district or your personal property. This has been going on for years. The residents in District 5 have stressed many times that we do not want this project. It does not matter to you how many people show up to a meeting. You have already made your decision. What will you do when an issue like this comes up in your neighborhood? Will you fight against it? Now that Southwest Mall is being revitalized, I personally think that the little bit of business you think will generate from the I-20 project for Duncanville will be a complete bust. This is a waste of tax dollars to such a small area. Look at all the businesses that left Duncanville to move to Cedar Hill. How did that work out for them? The shoppers will go back to Southwest Mall because it is convenient with one-stop shopping and parking. Please, put your concentration on the empty buildings and get them filled and vote no. Thank you.
Thank you. Jeff Burton.
Jeff Burton, 810 Delphi, here in Duncanville. Mayor, City Manager, Council, legal representation. Thank you for giving me the opportunity to voice my opinion. It's part of our system to be able to voice our beliefs and what we feel to be good, bad, or indifferent. I'm here to support and ask the Council to support TxDOT in developing these service roads. And we just heard that, yes, District 5 has voiced something that says it only affects them. It doesn't. This affects every person, every citizen of Duncanville. With the opportunity, we've talked for years, we don't have much land to develop. We've got the opportunity to have some retail, some restaurants, to line the service roads, as we see everywhere we drive. When you can get off the road, there's all the food to eat. We hope that it could also bring other types of retail business into the area. Most of that business is going to be on the eastbound direction of I-20. And so it is, to me, I believe it's a very, very interesting time and opportunity to be able to utilize some of the tax money we have spent by buying gasoline. And it's our money being spent as well. And it could go and should go. Now that this is in the TIF area, the amount of money generated from that in the future will help develop that entire area with the new TIF area that you started. I fully support it. I encourage our council to do the same. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. Wesley Jameson.
Wesley Jameson, 1214 Lady Lane, Duncanville. For a little over 10 years now, I've risen in opposition to this project, and it is because I live there, and it does affect me, and it does affect my neighbors, and it does affect the 300 or so people who have fought this thing over the years. The fantasy of a utopian economic boom over this I-20 service road, what is it, a half mile stretch, is come from a misguided perception or total lack of economic understanding. These service roads will go eastbound and westbound according to this proposal. The eastbound service roads were voted on and approved because they go through a commercial area. The westbound service roads from Camp Wisdom up to Main Street sever a residential area. Most of the people who moved to this part of Duncanville, the northern part, moved there because of the beauty of the landscaping, the trees, the topography. Not to have a Burger King or a Wendy's shoved on the corner, or as Duncanville seems to have done in their economic development, a title loan place or a payday loan place or a used car lot. Let's think again about the beauty and the best use of land and leave the neighborhoods alone. Develop the eastbound side where right now there's an empty old car dealership, and it makes sense to do that. Anyone who's driven along I-20 knows that when it starts backing up in Grand Prairie, nobody wants a big rig coming off a service road and driving through their neighborhood, because that's what's in store if these roads get developed, is someone's going to decide it's time to get off out of the traffic and head into the residential areas. I challenge anyone who drives an 18-wheeler to make that cut at Redbird Lane as it approaches Lady Lane. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. Stan Smith.
Thank you, Mayor, Mr. City Manager, honorable members of the council. I appreciate the opportunity to be here tonight. Live at 344 Fouts Avenue, Duncanville, Texas, 75137. I am in favor of this, as we've all known throughout our history, living on the south side of the river, that all highways get built for North Dallas and they get built through South Dallas. We don't ever get service roads in our end of town. This is our opportunity to get those service roads, and I encourage you to do service roads on both the eastbound and westbound side. TxDOT has proven over and over again it's not going to take any houses, even though that's not what people are being told. I would encourage y'all to support TxDOT and vote to pass this. Thank you very much.
Thank you. That's all the cards I have that people wishing to speak. So at this time, item number 5B is to consider a resolution of the City Council of the City of Duncanville, Texas, supporting the Texas Department of Transportation construction of the eastbound and westbound IH-20 frontage roads from North Main Street to Camp Wisdom Road and providing an effective date.
Thank you, Mayor, Council. My name's Mike Hassler. I'm the Director of Public Works here for the City of Duncanville. Would like to make a presentation to you about the facts and the information that we found about the design and construction of the frontage roads. First of all, our request is that the council consider and support the Texas Department of Transportation construction of the, both the east and westbound frontage roads from North Main to Camp Wisdom Roads Road. And we've got a number of reasons why we believe that's in the city's best interest. You've seen this presentation and you've seen the exhibits a number of times, so what I thought I would do is maybe go back a little bit and give you some of the history that's led up to today and where we are. The project benefits itself would improve the safety and mobility and enhance the city's image along the I-20 corridor between North Main Street and Camp Wisdom Road. We've been working with TxDOT to look at making some enhancements to that project where it doesn't look like every other section of I-20, where it would be unique to the city of Duncanville. So we've been working with the design team for months on different ideas for either the walls and or the bridge structures themselves. Construction of the frontage roads would improve the mobility, economic development, the traffic and pedestrian circulation, and improve access on the south side of the freeway. It would also enhance the mobility and traffic safety and protect the existing neighborhoods on the north side of the freeway by reducing cut-through traffic along and adjacent to the freeway corridor. And I'll show you some traffic counts here in just a minute that would support that contention. Again, we've kind of taken the emotion out of the situation, and we're looking at the facts of what would support whether this is a benefit or not to the city. Existing homes on the north side of the I-20 corridor will benefit by the installation of a potential sound wall if the majority of the adjacent property owners vote in favor of that sound wall. That meeting was originally scheduled earlier this month. It was canceled. It has not been rescheduled to my knowledge, but the state will meet with the affected property owners that would be directly affected by that sound wall, and they've told us if the residents don't want the sound wall, they won't have a sound wall. If the majority do want the sound wall, then a sound wall would be constructed. So in addition, we also have sidewalks that would improve pedestrian mobility and safety that aren't there today. Under history and background, the original project constructed frontage roads between Cockrell Hill and Cedar Ridge Drive. Now that occurred many, many years ago. Public comments received at a public meeting in July of 2008 shortened the project limits to the eastbound frontage road between North Main Street and Camp Wisdom Road. That's the project that's before you tonight. Per FHWA requirements, because I-20 is a federal highway, they dictated to TxDOT that they would have to actually design the schematic for both the eastbound and westbound frontage roads, regardless of whether we decide to improve just the east side, eastbound frontage roads or both east and westbound. But FHWA is the one, the entity that dictates the preparation of the schematics, going through all the environmental steps and things of that nature. TxDOT did stop on the public involvement and environmental process until the city passed a resolution this past December 2015 requesting them to proceed with the next required steps, again being the environmental process. A second public meeting was actually held on April 7th, 2016 to receive public comments A formal public hearing was held on December 13, 2016. I know a number of you were at that that meeting that was held just this last month. Now, looking back a little bit in a different capacity, in November of 2015, Insight Research Corporation was hired, and they conducted an economic impact analysis of the I-20 frontage road expansion projects. Their results determined that the extension of the frontage roads could have a significant impact on the redevelopment of Camp Wisdom Road and the area immediately surrounding that, and the overall economic impact to the community. Infrastructure, streetscaping, landscaping projects were identified in order to help enhance Camp Wisdom Road, to change it from its current appearance, and to create a sense of place and community. The analysis concluded that if the frontage road extensions were built and the proposed public infrastructure was completed, redevelopment of the area could create or retain 423 direct full-time equivalent jobs and produce a range of more than $15.3 million in new net direct taxes. This equates to approximately $765,000 in new direct tax revenue to the city of Duncanville. The next slide, again, you've seen this a number of times, so I won't go through it in any detail, other than I did want to point out, again, with the frontage roads, you can see on the see the green dot, but there's actually a ramp that would be built here that lines up with Winding Trail. That ramp would be gated, and it will have emergency access locks. They're called Knox boxes. Police, fire, ambulance all have access to that. Those boxes, they can get through them in a hurry. But that improvement would actually line up with Winding Creek instead of you having this kind of offset ramp here, but that this part of the frontage road would be rebuilt. The frontage road would then be extended over towards Main. This connection right here would be removed, and there would be a cul-de-sac built in this area to allow two-way traffic on Thrush. Unlike some prior comments that mentioned about forcing cut-through traffic through the neighborhoods, these frontage roads would actually keep that cut-through traffic from going into the neighborhoods, because you could exit directly off of I-20 and get right to Main Street without going on Thrush or on the east side of Winding Trail over by Wren. So you wouldn't have to go through the neighborhoods. On the south side, the state would rebuild a short section of the frontage road because they want to rebuild this new on-ramp here at a slightly different grade and alignment. They would also build this frontage road from Oriole to Camp Wisdom. The frontage road at Camp Wisdom and Cockrell Hill would then be signalized as part of those improvements. The traffic counts that we have here, and I apologize for the small font, probably should have used a much larger font. I found one mistake on this exhibit that I do want to point out to you. There's a number of 13,000 approximately vehicles per day, and that actually occurs right here just east of Main Street. So instead of truck traffic using this ramp or coming up here, they would be forced to stay on the frontage road to Main Street and make their right turn to go north on Main without going through this residential neighborhood or coming back further here and making a cut through on either Winding Trail or Oriole. We also looked at the pedestrian counts for Oriole, and we counted four different days. So far, we're actually doing some additional counts as we speak. The maximum number of pedestrians we counted in any one day was 10. Most of the time, it was either zero or just two or three pedestrians. The bridge on Oriole over I-20 does have sidewalks on both sides, so it can safely accommodate pedestrian traffic. There will be sidewalks built with the new frontage roads, and so again, we'll have an interconnection for pedestrian safety as well as vehicle safety, improved vehicle safety. So with that, that actually concludes my comments about the project. I would be glad to answer any questions that you might have about the work that we've done or any issue behind the research that we've done and the coordination with the state. So with that, I'll be glad to take your questions.
Seeing none, thank you very much.
Thank you, Mayor. Thank you, Council.
Chair will at this time entertain a motion concerning this item. Councilman Harvey.
Thank you, Mayor. I move that we approve the resolution of the City Council of the City of Duncanville. Oh, sorry. Resolution of the City Council of the City of Duncanville, Texas, supporting the TxDOT construction of the eastbound and westbound I-20 frontage roads from North Main Street to Camp Wisdom Road.
And provide an effective date.
And provide an effective date.
Okay, is there a second to that motion?
I second it.
There's a motion and a second on the floor. Is there any further discussion? If not, will you please vote?
I'm sorry, I'm still waiting for.
Okay, thank you very much. Item number 5C is consider a resolution of the City Council of the City of Duncanville, Texas, establishing the Duncanville's, oops, we pulled that one, I'm sorry. We have pulled that from the agenda for further study. We've got some questions and the council will probably conduct a meeting before we bring that back and put it on the agenda. Item number D is to take any necessary action as a result of the executive committee. We ran out of time. We have not had the executive committee. We're going to hold it in just a few moments, but what I'm going to do is recess this regular session. We will call the council into executive session in the briefing room. Following the executive session, we will adjourn that and we will open our general meeting again in the briefing room and adjourn in the briefing room. So at this time, I am going to recess this regular session at 40 is that on the count? Where's
your next page?
Oh, okay. I've got one more page. I'm sorry. But that's what we're going to do, and we will adjourn the council meeting in the briefing room after we finish with the executive session. And I did not turn the page, and item number 6 is staff reports, and we're to receive the Public Works quarterly report and work plan update.
Well, again, Mayor, thank you. I'll be quick on this. I know it's getting late, and we've been busy this quarter in Public Works, and so I hope to show you some of the things that we have been doing. First of all, from a personnel perspective, we've actually hired 2 code enforcement inspectors. Robert Weisinger began work on November 7th, so just about 2 months ago. He was hired as a result of the council expressing a need for an additional code enforcement officer as part of the budget process. Robert began his code enforcement career with the city of Texarkana over 18 years ago. And so I know I have talked with him on a number of occasions. He's hit the ground running and has been an excellent resource for the city. We also hired Joseph Soto just about a week later. And Joseph was actually hired to cover the area of the city covered by the Community Development Block Grant program. Joseph began his code enforcement career with the city of Irving over 9 years ago. So again, another very experienced employee that was able to hit the ground running. And again, I visited with him, and he's an excellent employee and very enthusiastic about the opportunity to work here at our city. This first one, I'm very pleased to be able to stand here and tell you finally we've been able to make an offer for a new senior building inspector. Greg Contreras and I interviewed a gentleman a week before last who, his name is James Slachter. And James is a licensed plumbing inspector with over 28 years of experience in both plumbing and inspection fields. He also has the capability of doing plan review as well as permit inspections. James most recently worked for the cities of Lancaster, where I believe he was actually the building official for a short period of time at Lancaster, and also for the town of Hutchins. We also hired Lynette Jimenez, and she began work for us a little over a month ago. And she was hired to provide additional clerical help in building inspections because we were having a lot of trouble keeping up with all of the paperwork for the application of permits and for filling out the paperwork for certificates of occupancy. I'll get that out. She's previously worked for the city of Cockrell Hill as a court clerk. What is the unfortunate news, though, this evening is Lynette was, when you hire good employees, you always run the risk of losing them. And we've already lost Lynette, at least for a part time, to one of our other departments. I think she's going to start in the finance department here shortly. Well, I guess payback.
Do y'all often steal employees from each other?
Yes, sir. That's what I said. That's the danger of hiring good employees is other people soon find out how good they are. But going on to recent accomplishments, this is one that I'm kind of particularly proud of, and that is along 10 Mile Creek, it's a bag wall program. And if you're not familiar with what a bag wall is, they look like bags of concrete, almost like sacrete, but they have a paper coating that decomposes over time, and as it decomposes, instead of seeing those bags, what you see is what looks like almost a natural stone or a natural rock finish. Now, this is the largest and highest wall that we have built. It's 87 feet long, and at its highest point, it's 29 feet high. The project was constructed with a 50-50 contribution between two homeowners in the city, and it took about 2 months to build at a cost of about $110,000. So we're real proud of this wall, again, because of its size, and we believe it will adequately protect these two residences that are just in these photos would be to the left of the wall. If we move on to recent accomplishments, I think you've already seen this and heard about this before, but the street division went out and did some level up on Camp Wisdom at the railroad tracks to get rid of a large asphalt hump that was there. We also did some level up work on Main Street to eliminate that severe dip there. I've actually gone through that. If police Chief is not in the room. I've actually gone through that intersection at a little higher than the posted speed as a test, just to see if we improved the character of that dip, and you can actually go through it very safely at the posted speed limit. So again, we're real proud of the street division work. It took them quite some time, and they were able to deal with the railroad much quicker than I thought was possible. We also completed, and Councilman Jameson asked about this earlier, about the item on the agenda for the actual second phase of water and wastewater improvements in the Roma area, but we actually did replace a water line from Greenstone to West Ridge. We replaced a wastewater line via pipe bursting. We did some street reconstruction, and we changed non-compliant sidewalks and installed ramps for full ADA compliance, which is a huge item these days. ADA compliance, cities around us have been sued for being out of compliance, and so anytime we can, we try to improve the intersections in those ramps. Barson Utilities is a very experienced contractor. We've had good luck working with them, and they completed all of this work for just under $1 million. So it was a very, very good project for us. I didn't want to put up 22 work plan items and have you stare at that screen and go, oh my gosh, he's going to cover every one of those. So what I want to tell you is that we actually have a total of 22 work plan items. We've completed actually one of the projects, sidewalk repair and rehabilitation, that's been completed. There's 14 work plan items that are in progress out of those 22. Four of the work plans will begin later this month or in the third quarter. And I want to be sure and make sure Councilman Jameson understands that the Redbird signal is scheduled to begin this month. We worked with Encore, and Encore was able to find a way to not have to relocate all of their poles at that intersection, which allowed us to accelerate the construction of this project. So we have the materials in, and we're about ready to start. So I wanted to make sure that you knew that we were about ready to begin that signal finally.
Accelerate.
Well, really? had we had to wait for the Encore improvements, it wouldn't start in January, but it's going to start in January, Ms. Jameson, and so I'm glad to report that to you. I know you've been patient and waiting for that. And unfortunately, three of the work plan items are on hold for a variety of reasons. But out of the 22 items, you can see we're busy on the majority of those right now. And so if you want to, I've got a little cheat sheet here. I can tell you the status of any one of those items. Quarterly performance indicators. I thought you might be interested in just seeing how much water we pumped between October and December of 2016, the first fiscal quarter of this year, of 336 million gallons of water. The water amount of water that we pumped last fiscal year is 1,825,000,000 gallons of water for a full 12-month period. And of course, I'm not going to read all of these numbers here, but you can see that we've cleaned about 28 miles of sanitary sewer. We've provided 146 preventative vehicle maintenance checks. We've inspected 402 drainage headwalls and cleaned them if necessary. That's a significant figure towards keeping residential or industrial flooding to a minimum so that we don't have the problems that you've seen in the past. So I think between that and the improvements that we've made through pipe bursting and other water and wastewater improvements, you're going to see a significant reduction in the sanitary sewer overflows, and I think you'll see a reduction in the high water buildup where we've experienced that across town, and we're continuing to work on that just every day. That's something that both the street division and water and wastewater division work on every day. With that, I'll conclude my comments and ask if you have any questions about, again, what we've done or what we have planned.
Mike.
Yes, sir.
Can you give us just a thumbnail update on where we are with the projects that the pavement management system generated, or some projects under design, or where do we stand on some of those?
Councilman Schwartz, I can't give you an exact figure. We meet once a month between drainage, water, wastewater, and the paving and administration, and we look at the street projects that we can design. What we're looking for is to try to figure out whether or not we have water problems, wastewater problems, drainage problems, or pavement. And I'm sorry, I can't give you an answer to that right now, but I will get you an answer, and I'll be glad to let you and the rest of the council know that.
Yeah, I'm the next time you report, I would just like to know kind of how we're progressing on
yes.
the pavement management system.
We are starting. It's kind of a slow start process because of that coordination. We have to figure out whether or not we don't want to do the proverbial fix the street and then come in and open cut it to put in a water line. So that's why the coordination is taking a little bit more time than I had hoped. But we've got all the right people involved within the department, but I'll be glad to report that at my next update. So, yes, sir, I sure will.
Measure twice, cut once.
Pardon?
I was saying measure twice, cut once.
Well, thank you very much, Mike. If the police chief's in the back of the room, if you'll provide the date and time that this occurred, he'll be glad to accommodate you.
Yes, I was hoping he had left by now.
Thank you so much.
Thank you, Mayor. Thank you, Council.
I will. It's 8:04, and I will go ahead and recess this meeting when then I'm asking the council to go to the briefing room, and we will open an executive session.
Now it's 9:27, adjourned our executive committee meeting. So at 9:28,
okay.
I'm going to call the regular council meeting back into order. The one item that we had left was to present anything that was passed in the executive session. There was nothing passed in the executive session. It was for information only. So at this time, there are no further items to be brought before the council tonight. So at 9:28, I will adjourn our city council meeting.
Thank you.